Hello, everyone, and welcome back to G-Flix. Our next episode starts in now.
Aw, man, it sucks that they're taking No More Heroes off of G-Flix for forever. You know, it's just a...
I don't believe any of that anymore. Like, unless it's like a well-renowned series like The Office or what else was taken off permanently and that actually was permanent.
Just right now, the like it just announced a couple of days ago that Willow is being taken off of Disney Plus.
Really?
And there were a couple of other big things that were being taken off, but Willow is the one I remember mostly. And of course, people are upset about that because Willow is a big cult classic fantasy thing. So of course, the nerds are going to be upset about that. But yeah, so, you know, living in a...
Hold on to your Willow DVDs and Blu-rays.
You can't get them anymore, though, is the thing, unless you want to shell out $1 billion.
They're locked away in the Disney vault.
Oh, yeah, the Disney vault. Everybody's got to love the Disney vault. I mean, it's just kind of a weird thing when you think about it, because you backtrack in time 50 years ago to the 70s and 60s. Where home video wasn't even a thing. If, like, let's say your favorite Disney movie was Snow White. Snow White was only in theaters every once in a while because that's how theaters worked. They played old movies pretty rarely and, like, on rotation. So it is just pretty strange that, like, now we're living in a situation where, like, before, you know, certain things just get tucked away until the company wants us to see them again. So I just find that interesting.
In some strange way, it's kind of a reversion of how it used to be.
Because it certainly does work in Disney's favor, where it's just like Willow's back on Disney Plus, and then they get all of those people to resubscribe to their things, you know.
Yeah, it's like a special event. Like it's when like back in the day before the VHS was even a thing, where holiday specials that you only could see once a year.
Yeah, my parents
was turning on. It's like you better watch the telly right now because it's on now.
My parents they still do that on some of the networks. They'll play like Sound of Music and Wizard of Oz only like once a year, and my parents will still sit down and watch them on those specific dates because they love those movies and it's a special thing, even though I absolutely could definitely watch Wizard of Oz right now if I wanted to.
Same with my mom absolutely loves the Ten Commandments. And I tell her, listen, you know you can get it up, stream this or watch it on DVD at any time, right? Because you realize with commercials, this shit is 8 hours long. But she is just hard committed to watching it on a specific day because that is what she grew up with.
I mean, that one also does have like the time portion where it's like not really Easter-y. It's a Passover-y kind of thing where they'll play it in like March. You know, so there's that. And same thing with like the freaking Rankin-Bass Christmas specials. Although, listen,
Rankin-Bass? I never heard of that.
They're the people who made Frosty the Snowman. Reindeers. All those bad ones. Because they're bad. They're not good. I guess, you know, it was, life must have been so hard in the 60s with their functioning economy.
I gotta say, Christmas movies was a strange time before Die Hard.
Listen, I have thoughts about the Die Hard Christmas thing, but I'm not gonna get into it right now.
Okay, fine. Batman Returns. Ooh, no immediate response for that one. I think I have something here.
Oh my god. Oh, jeez.
Is Nightmare Before Christmas a Christmas movie? Or,
it's both.
Or are we gonna meet in the middle and say it's a Thanksgiving movie?
No, it's both. It's not being Thanksgiving. It's not even Thanksgiving's not even accurate.
It's Hot Topic gets 30% more sales for 3 months. Movie.
Nightmare Before Christmas is literally the embodiment of Christmas of a Christmas store becoming a spirit Halloween.
Yeah. Oh, geez. Yeah. I gotta know how they set up the stores so fast because if a spirit, like there was not too long ago where Sears near me shut down, and it was like beginning of the fall, right, like September, and within like a week or two, the Spirit Halloween had already set up shop. And I gotta wonder how they how they do that. Like, so do they have like Spirit Jacqueline, Jack-o'-lantern fairies stock the store for them?
See, the thing is, and I'm somewhat being half serious about this, converting a store, warehouse, department, or otherwise into a Spirit Halloween has to be some of the most low effort shit available, right? Because what makes a Spirit Halloween? It's that banner on the front of the store, right? You can make that banner in a day, and all you gotta do is hang it up. That's
it. Yeah, but you also gotta,
there's a Spirit Halloween.
Oh, poor Travis. You also gotta move, like, stock the entire store, though. There's a lot of shit in there, you know?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. But, you know, you put some cobwebs
in
there.
And I'm sure they have to do some legal shit in order to get the rights to work in the store, unless if they don't, and then they just, like, set up a shop and the cops don't care.
The cops are busy looking at the memorabilia.
No, they probably think they'll get more money getting the parking tickets for people trying to go into the Spirit Halloween, whereas it would cost them money to try to get those guys out. So, you know, you got to think in the big brain. mode.
Yeah.
Have we been to the Thunderdome yet?
Yes.
Okay.
Earlier in the game.
Sunday.
Early in the game. That was like fucking 8 months ago.
I'm just saying we have.
As far as I know, we've never been to Thunderdome.
What was the original Thunderdome? Because it's just kind of like a saying now. Kind of like, I don't know what the original sequel that was Electric Boogaloo. I don't know what the original Electric Boogaloo was.
Well, the term Thunderdome, does that stem from the movie?
Probably.
Because I think there was Mad Max, right? Mad Max had Thunderdome.
Oh, then it was Mad Max. Okay. I haven't.
Mad Max the 85 film, Beyond Thunderdome.
I haven't watched the old Mad Max movies. I'd only seen the new one, which is good. Don't get me wrong. I just kind of don't get it as much as other people do.
Yeah. Well, okay, sure. I think the Thunderdome does originate from Mad Max, because that was the name of the arena for the steel cage fights.
Yeah, I don't think I get Mad Max Fury Road. I feel the same way about it as I do about Batman Dark Knight, where it's certainly a very good movie. I just don't see what makes it, like, the bestest movie.
Admittedly, it's been a couple of years since I watched it myself, but I just remember just being enamored visually by just how
gorgeous the film was. I mean, I think of that movie being, like, fairly recent, and it's probably 10 years old. hold on a moment. We're looking it up.
No, it has to be probably 8 years.
I think we've done more Google searches in this 2015. Yeah, it's getting close.
It's been 8 years. Close to 8 years.
Yeah.
Holy shit, I cannot believe it's already been 8 years.
Yeah, well, three of those happened during the anime time skip, so it's like they don't even really count.
Oh, okay.
You know.
Oh, is that what we're calling it now?
It might as well
the
be
anime
what
time
it
skip?
Is now. There's something psychological about these sorts of events, because the Spanish pandemic was similar. There's not a lot of like memoirs or anything that goes into detail about that either. So people just kind of like don't want to think about that time where they were locked in their house for a year or plus. So they just don't talk about it. And I'm sure that's extremely psychologically healthy for everybody. 100%.
No. Absolutely not.
You're no fun.
No. I'm just trying to chain Thunderdome into Spanish pandemic, personally. My brain's been racking about that for about a minute.
I still did have a point about Mad Max, though, in that there's the scene early on in the movie with the bad guy, and he's like bringing out the small drip of water for all the people to drink, and he's like, do not let yourself become addicted to water. And every time I see that scene, I think of everybody, like, I think of him just dropping coffee out of the window and be like, do not let yourself become addicted to coffee. It will make you weak. And that's just me.
Meanwhile, I'm down there. I was like, y'all hear something? You fucking open the gate. Open the gate.
Dude's right, though. Water's a scam. I've been, for the past year and change, I've been doing all the things people have been saying about drinking more water, staying hydrated, all that shit. I don't feel any different.
Right.
All I just do is pee more. So I think this is a scam by Big Water to get us to drink more water.
From the Wicked Witch of the West subsidiaries. Water's a scam. Don't drink water.
Wait, was the witch the one who drowned? Not drowned, melted? The West, sorry.
Wicked Witch of the West.
The West one was the one who drowned, melted. I can never remember which one's the good one and which one's the bad one. Like, what direction?
Well, was it the Wicked Witch of the East?
That got flattened by the house. There was,
it's Glinda that was, okay, the Good Witch.
That was the one that crashed by the house.
Glinda the Good Witch.
Glinda the Good Witch. But wasn't she also, like, she's related to the
Wicked Witch?
Yeah, I think it depends on what canon you go by. We're not going by the Wicked canon. All right, the Wicked canon sucks. So the Wicked Witch... One of the Wicked Witches gets stomped by the house, and then the other one is reasonably upset at Dorothy murdering her sister in Val's Revenge.
Right.
What was the TV guide listing for Wizard of Oz? The young woman murders the first person she meets and then vows to kill again. Or something like that.
Like, you do have to think, though, that she's extremely lucky that that she lands her house on the most hated person on the planet. You know, it's kind of like if somebody... Like, if an alien crash landed their UFO onto planet Earth and they landed on Jeffrey Dahmer, it's just like, well, that's certainly convenient because you could have landed on, like, Mother Teresa instead, and then we'd be a little bit screwed. It's a lot better for PR, is just what I'm saying, to make sure you land on Jeffrey Dahmer versus Mother Teresa. Because it's just as likely to happen, don't you know?
I mean, they're both already dead, so it's what difference would it make?
Well, but as we all know, alien abductions only happened in the 60s and 70s. They got bored and left, which is why you don't see UFOs anymore.
Yeah, at that point, people moved on from PCP.
Yeah, and it has nothing to do with the fact that
the aliens disappeared.
Personal camera technology has increased dramatically since that time. Absolutely nothing. Actually, speaking of the Wizard of Oz, weren't they doing they were doing Wicked again. God damn it. I hate Wicked so much.
Well, what's wrong with Wicked, if you don't mind me asking? Because, like, I never watched it. I never watched the play either.
So, I'm, like, 80% sure I've gone on this diatribe before. However, okay. It's probably...
What's one more?
Yeah. So, here's the thing. The music is fine. And there's honestly a decent amount of pretty funny jokes in the like script as well, if you like, you know, corny musical humor, kind of in the not quite Rodgers and Hammerstein style. The problem is just that they decide to add drama by just completely retconning the fuck out of the original. I shouldn't say the original, because they base it off of the movie instead of the books, but it's like, instead of making an interesting point about how there's two sides to every story, which is certainly, you know, a interesting take on something, you know, instead of trying to do something cool with that, they're just like, okay, instead of there just being two sides to every story and the witch might be justified in what she's doing, it's just, oh, the witch was the good guy all along, which I just find incredibly lazy and dumb. It's like, oh, the Tin Man was actually an asshole, and the Scarecrow actually loved the witch the whole time, and the wizard's like a date rapist, and it's like, and I'm not even joking, that's literally like what he is in Wicked, and I'm like, y'all are reaching quite a bit here.
Was this in the original book?
In the Wicked book, yes. As far as I can...
No, I mean, like, is it... Because I don't remember any of that from The Wizard of Oz. Like, the film adaptation?
It's all made up. Wicked was its own book by a different author.
Okay.
But, and the play is much more based on the Wizard of Oz movie. I haven't read Wicked the book, so I can't speak much about the book, if the book is based on the books or if it's based on the movie. I'm not sure. But all I can say is about the play is that It takes an interesting concept. What I thought you could like launch off of that.
You think, but
apparently not.
So it takes an interesting concept of like, oh, let's see, because the witch, Wicked Witch, is like literally like one of the most classic evil stereotypical villains ever. So it's like, what if we tried to make a nuanced version of a typically evil character? Interesting. I find it less interesting when instead of trying to make a sympathetic character with complex, you know, things going on, they say, oh, she's actually the good guy. I just find that trite and lame. The fact that they just decide to retcon basically the entire movie just pisses me off. Just because it's like, oh, they just want to make a point. They don't care about like actually making this a different, like a telling of a like, oh, this is the other side of the story. It's just a, oh, we're just going to change things we don't like. It makes me upset. Wicked annoys me.
Well, I'm not entirely against writing or rewriting a classic story to make it more contemporary.
I'm not against that either. I should also note.
Yeah.
To put it a different way, imagine if they made Frieza the good guy in.
Yeah.
You know,
like in the same continuity as like Dragon Ball's where it's now.
Yeah.
You know, because it's different for me specifically when it's clear from the get-go that this is like, to use like comic books as a comparison, an Elseworlds tale. You know what I mean? Where they can literally get away with doing literally anything because it does not matter.
Yeah, I guess that's kind of the thing is that, well, for one, Wicked has sequels in the book at the very least. So it's like its own. And it's not in the same continuity in the sense that Wizard of Oz is a public domain property. They can do whatever the hell they want. But the thing I think for me is that since the play is following so close to the style of the movie, it very clearly is trying to be like, oh, this is the movie, but the witch's side, versus many of the Elseworld tales or the what if tales that you see in Marvel or whatever. It's not like like Logan, just as an example, where Logan is very clearly trying to do its own thing. The vibe Wicked is going for is, oh, you know that, and I'm pretty sure the play actually starts off with it. It's like, you know this story, but you don't know this side of the story. Ooh. It's like, yeah. But yeah, no, I'm...
These are the true stories of the Wicked Witch of the West.
It's like, I don't have any problem with that necessarily. I don't even necessarily having added context change your view of characters you already know. Like, John, did you read To Kill a Mockingbird in high school?
I don't believe I did.
Okay, then this isn't gonna really matter, mean much to you. But To Kill a Mockingbird, it's a book that they often will have you read in school. It's actually pretty good. It's one that I didn't mind reading when I was in high school. But basically, the story is, it takes place in the, I think it's pre-segregation South, like the 40s-ish.
Yeah.
Maybe. Oh God, I can't remember any of the characters' names. It's been a while. But basically, the story follows Atticus Finch. Thank you. So Atticus Finch is a lawyer. And a black man in the town is falsely accused of assaulting a white woman, basically. And it's pretty damn clear that he didn't do it, but they want to blame the black guy anyway, cause it's easier. And also cause they're racist. And so
that'll do it. Yeah.
And so the story is told from the perspective of Atticus's daughter, who is, you know, like the innocent kind of blank slate sort of character who doesn't quite get the realities of the racist world they live in. You know, and so Atticus has this big talk with her where it's just like, this is my client and I'm going to do everything I can for my client. Harper Lee, the author of the book, later released a sequel, like way after, like fairly recently, actually, within the past 10 or 20 years, called Go Set a Watchman or Go See a Watchman, something like that. And it basically confirms that Finch is basically just as racist as everybody else in the town. He just cares about doing his job well more than he cares about being racist, effectively.
Yeah.
So, and that's like, a lot of people got really pissed off about that because they internalized Atticus Finch as being a good guy, you know? Whereas it makes more sense where no matter how good of a person, a white person, I should say, was during that era, or how good they thought they were, I guess I should say, you know, a lot of racial bias still seeped in because it was the fucking South in the 1940s, of course.
It might as well have been like the norm in some
fashion. So it's like, I don't necessarily mind that kind of, even though it is technically a retcon, it's like, it does add some more texture to the character, even though it's disappointing. And part of the theme of that book is the girl's now grown up. And so now she's now seeing the world from a more adult, nuanced point of view. So like, it fits with the themes of what they're trying to go for, even as well. So that kind of thing doesn't necessarily bother me. It just bothers me when it's done badly, and Wicked's done badly in this essay. I've already done the essay. Shit, the joke doesn't work.
I was going to say, oh, you went in reverse.